Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 11th running of the Mental Takedown. Hope this day is finding everybody well as we are back for another episode. Of course, this episode, we had to bring on somebody big, and it is none other than VITO ARUJAU that has a laundry list of both folk style and freestyle accomplishments. Two-time All-American, stud for Cornell, has way too many freestyle accomplishments for me to even continue to rattle off. Third at the US Open, made junior world teams, and is training for the 2021 Olympics. Now, in a minute, you'll hear my sad attempt at trying to pull off this intro in Russian. As you, most of you know, that Vito is, parents are originally from the Soviet Union. It's a great interview. He is one of the most laid-back and humble guys I've had on the show. Thank you so much, Vito, for doing this. And, of course, without further ado, and without more of my ugly voice, roll the clip.
Всем привет! Добро пожаловать на шоу The Mental Takedown. Сегодня мы имеем Vito Arujau. How are we doing?
Hey, how's it going?
All right. For those of you who are wondering what the heck I just said, that's my sad attempt at Russian. 85% Google Translate, 10% cramming YouTube videos in the past week, 5% watching way too many chess videos, and 1% dumb luck. So.
One. That bad. It was kind of bad, but it wasn't that bad.
Oh, yeah. It was bad. But, you know, I wondered, I already made a fool out of myself having done, like, 8 of these episodes. I probably already look like an idiot anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
Nice.
I always joke that I'm 1% Russian because my favorite two things in life are chess and wrestling, which is 1-2 in Russia, interchangeably, pretty much. Now that I guess that's an icebreaker, I guess that segues into my first question. I guess culturally, having lived in a Russian household your whole life, and I guess what are some of the differences between here in the US and in Russia, both on and off the mat, I guess?
What are some of the differences between like my household and like comparative to a different household, like an American household?
I guess, yeah, culturally.
Well, I don't know. I think my family dynamic at home is just a little bit different because my dad is also my coach, you know. I think that has a stronger hold over the actual like Russian side of the household. Obviously, like, we do things a little bit differently. The food we eat's a little different. Some of the things that my parents will preach are a little bit different. Like, you know, you got to wear socks inside the house, otherwise your back will hurt. You know, like weird little things that you have to take your shoes off at the front door. Like some things that like most people don't really understand, but like it's just like a cultural thing that's brought over, and there's no question really asked about it. You know. Yeah. I mean, I grew up fine.
Yeah, and I guess having your father as a coach and him being a very good wrestler himself, and that's not to be taken lightly, I guess, how does that contribute to the way that you wrestle now?
You know, my dad definitely trained me, you know, all by himself, basically for the first, until I left for college, I only had one coach. So he taught me everything I knew up to that point. And I was pretty good for it. I mean, he's got some great skills on the mat. And you know, just the things that he taught me about like just life in general were very helpful to wrestling, and then like, you know, everything outside of wrestling too. So I'm pretty happy that I got to have my dad be my coach, my dad be my dad.
And was it difficult at times to kind of separate the two, or did y'all never have kind of that issue? Because I know some people have had issues where it doesn't work out too well, where when your parents are so heavily invested in, I guess, what you do for a living basically now.
So yeah, there's definitely like a very, very fine line between like father and coach in most situations. I think we just kind of look at it like both. So like at any given point, like he'll tell me something like as a coach, and then like at any given point I'll be like, you know, a father at the same time. He's just more of a mentor, I guess. You know, he always has the best in mind, and I think there's a lot of similarities between what a coach and a father want to do for you, and they always end up wanting to have wanting you to do the best that you can. So I think a lot of the times, like, there's definitely some times where, you know, I would need a dad instead of a coach, and sometimes I would need a coach instead of a dad. But I think that he did probably a better job than the vast majority of coach fathers that have tried it, you know. Yeah. And also, you know, he understands that there's more to life than just wrestling. So he has, like, perspective on this. And, you know, he's done everything that I've done to this point, so he has experience in it too. So, you know, I probably couldn't ask for a better role model.
I guess just wondering, coming from a lineage of wrestlers, were you kind of, was it just naturally that, like, as soon as you could walk, you had wrestling shoes on, just like how chess dads, as soon as they can talk, they throw a chessboard in front of their face and tell children, go?
I didn't start, like, formally training wrestling until, like, sixth grade.
Oh, wow.
So I think my dad just didn't want me to get burnt out, but also, like, he was, because wrestling, he has a wrestling gym on Long Island.
Yeah.
So, as much as, like, him trying to teach me, and also, like, he has to, like, run his business, you know, because it is a business. And I think that what he saw was the best move was just, like, have me start a little bit later and just catch up, because he knew I'd be able to catch up.
Nice. I guess switching gears a little bit. Granted, this is, I guess, having ever since the whole coronavirus just kind of shut the whole world down, I guess, what's it been like having something to actually train for, I guess? Whereas in the past, maybe, 3 months, you've been, like, just training, but don't know exactly for what.
It's definitely pretty cool, having, like, an actual thing to get ready for, because it's not really the training that it's, like, the training for prepping for a competition is different, you know. You kind of want to, like, schedule your days in a way that allows you to peak for the tournament, and whereas, maybe I was just going, like, hard every single day, you know, in training for my dad, because at the end of the day, like, I was still training, even though I didn't have an immediate competition, you know. I'm still training to get ready for the Olympic Games that are going to come next year. So I was training regardless. Like, I have a goal in mind. It's just so off into the horizon that it's sometimes, like, hard to see, like, what I'm doing right now. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So there's definitely a fresh little change of pace. Like, I have something to do, basically.
Yeah. Wow. And I guess what I heard was you just basically took the bout, no questions asked, right?
Yeah. I mean, they asked me to wrestle, and I wanted to wrestle, you know?
Yeah.
You know, people on, like, most people who like wrestle competitively, like, with the higher level people, you know, it's hard to just, like, stop. It's kind of most, you know, like, I have to go to a tournament. Like, I want to wrestle. Yeah, so I felt like I just really wanted to get on the mat. And, like, especially in this time where no one's wrestling, I kind of see it as, like, an advantage. Like, I'm going to be less rusty than most because I have wrestled, you know.
I guess then, was it difficult at all to, like, during this redshirt year to kind of just sit out and watch Cornell from the sidelines?
Yes and no, because I knew there were some times where I could have helped their outcome. Like during the Princeton match that we lost, you know, I knew if I did wrestle, like, I would have definitely helped the outcome. We most likely would have won. And that's just real hard to sit there and just watch. But I knew that I had a greater goal in mind than just, like, one college dual meet match, you know. At the end of the day, like, it's not that big of a deal. You know, all our guys will still do well in NCAAs. Like, we have a solid shot at a team title. So, like, at that point when I was sitting there, you know, I was like, all right, like, I have to make this worth it. I have to train a little harder, like, when the Olympic trials come.
To be fair, it wasn't just you, though. Y'all had, like, half the team gone last year, right?
Yeah, but any one of us brought back would have switched up the
business. Yeah.
If you just threw Yanni in there, like, we would have won.
Exactly.
If you threw Max in, we would have won. So, like, it's just tough. We benched literally, like me, Max, and Yanni were, like, pretty solid hammers. Like, we were almost guaranteed wins.
That's at least 12, if 15 points, depending on who you are wrestling per duel, yeah?
Like, we can score bonus points, too. The last Penn State duel that we wrestled the year before this, like, I ended up pinning Pat Glory, and I was a 12-point swing. Like,
yeah.
That's pretty sick, or 6-point swing, but.
Those are how those things go. Well, I guess also having wrestling in the Ivy League, are the non-conference duels off this year? I think they are, no?
I have no idea what is going on with the season. I'm more or less just focusing on what's in front of me, you know?
Okay.
That's going to come later. Like, I'll worry about it later.
Okay. So, for now, it's just get past next week, yeah, first.
Let the people who are going to decide it figure it out, you know? It's not like I'm the one making the decision, so I'll just let them do what they want, and whatever they let me wrestle, I'll wrestle in.
All right. I guess the idea of folk style versus freestyle, what are kind of the way you, like, I guess your style, how do they suit both or don't suit both?
I think I'm pretty good at both styles. Because, you know, I have a pretty good skills in, like, folk style, just from my hand fighting and my shot finish rate on top. And towards the end of the season, I learned how to, like, effectively ride people. I think was the solidify that, like, I can now be good at folk style. You know, I've always been, like, pretty decent at bottom because I'm a little squirrely, so I could just hop up or, like, you know, maybe get a reversal, like, pull you underneath and hip over. And then for freestyle, I mean, you know, I have some of the best mentors in that too. You know, like, I've definitely grown my freestyle skills. I'm definitely most confident on my feet as well, so it translates well in a freestyle where most of the initiations to scores have to be takedowns. You know, like, you can't just start in top bottom. So I feel pretty confident getting two takedowns and then working on transitioning into a turn. But, you know, for folk style help, I have, like, my coach Mike Gray, Kyle Dake, my father. Like, these are all great folk style wrestlers. And then also, like, freestyle, the same people, like Mike Gray, Kyle Dake, and my dad are all insane freestyle wrestlers. So I feel pretty comfortable in both places.
And is it difficult at all to, like, kind of switch between styles? Or, I mean, I guess usually you don't wrestle them that close to one another, but I guess after less than a couple months of folk style throughout the season.
So after NCAAs are done, you have just about like a month to switch your style over from folk style to freestyle to get ready for the US Open.
Yeah.
Or whatever it was that was it the US Open? I think it was the US Open. And you know, sometimes like you need to refine your, cause it's basically a whole different style, you know, yeah. Like it's almost a whole different sport is what I was trying to say.
Yeah.
You know, you have your takedowns, but you're not trying to control him. You're trying to stay on the offense once you already get him taken down. So you have to work on your transitions and your bottom defense and your gut wrench, you know, and even like your setups, like you can't be sloppy on getting to a leg, like, cause you can't expose yourself at all. Otherwise you'll end up giving up more points than you get, you know?
Yeah.
So a lot to take in, and it's pretty hard to just go off the bat, be like, hey, okay. Like unless you've trained both styles heavily, I think for most people, it's tough to transition so quickly into that. I think I've gotten a lot better at it now because I've had a lot of practice in both areas. And most of my shots are the same shots that I hit in both styles, you know? But yeah.
And does that just come with experience having done it for so many years in a way?
I think so. I think I'm really confident. Like I know what my freestyle technique is. So I know like when I need to go back into freestyle, you know, the same as how, as soon as I have to wrestle folk style again, like I already know my set folk style moves. So I'm just going to drill them and refine those things like they're, and I know the technique well enough to this point where it's going to be fine adjustments, not like having to relearn the entirety of, because a lot of times, like I remember like when I was in high school or something, you know, I come off folk style season, I have to wrestle freestyle now, like I forgot what I did the year before. I got to relearn a whole, like how to do a gut wrench properly and a leg lace and transitions. But now I feel comfortable to the point where I know how I like to hit my things and I'm good at them. So now if I take a long break from it, it's just going to be like small tweaks that'll end up getting it back to where it was. It's like riding a bike.
Yeah. I guess, what are some of the differences where compared to international competition where you meet, like here in the US, when you wrestle during the college season, you're basically wrestling the same guys two or three times a year, whereas internationally, you're wrestling someone you've never met before. Is there kind of differences psychologically in the way you approach things?
So when I was younger, my first international tournament was the Cadet World Championship in Tbilisi, Georgia, right? So when I first went there, I was really scared to wrestle these foreigners because I, you know, always heard about them growing up being like amazing at wrestling. And then after the first couple rounds, I realized, oh, like they're just like us. They just wrestle different.
They're still people. Yeah.
They're still people, you know, they're definitely beatable. The Russians, like, yeah, they're really good at wrestling, but like, you're at the World Championships too. Like, you're probably also pretty good at wrestling. And it goes for the same, like, you know, they wrestle differently. It's not the same style, right? But you could definitely find, like, multiple people in the U.S. who have different styles, you know? Our style is much more heavily influenced by folk style because everyone has wrestled folk style growing up, you know? So our freestyles technique is like very influenced by like grabbing and like pulling the head and like moving and setting up shots and like lifting, you know, whereas freestyle like is much more oriented around like skill instead of like conditioning, you know, like they'll hit foot sweeps, they'll hit arm drags, they'll hit like an arm throw, you know, inside trips, like all these moves that, like, you know, we see some guys do, all of their guys hit that consistently. So I think that's like the main difference between, like, or your question was more so, right, how does it fare wrestling them versus us? When you know, wrestle more international tournaments, you end up seeing the same guys.
Yeah, I guess. Eventually, evens out. Yeah.
And then the Euregan, and then the whatever else tournament. Like, it'll probably be the same couple guys who are leading boards on the freestyle and the Russian team, you know? So it is kind of like, instead of, like, in the U.S., like, we have our colleges, and we all have our best guy from the college, and they go, you know, they're – it's just a bigger scale, so it's just the best guy from each country goes and then represents, you know?
Yeah. And I guess, is that kind of more focused on technical? Do you think that's forced because they only wrestle freestyle, that's all they know? Or is it more culturally kind of the way that Russians grow up or something?
So I think it's definitely, you know, they don't know folk style. Yeah. If you take a random kid and ask him to wrestle folk style with you, he's like, what's that?
Yeah.
Like, when you come to America or, like, watch, like, on Flow, you know, that you can actually learn about folk style, because your entire life you're growing up thinking there's freestyle and Greco. You're not, like, your coach is never showing you folk style technique, because you'll never wrestle folk style in your life unless you, like, move to America, you know? So it's definitely heavily influenced by the fact that they don't have, you know, so they can focus on all these different moves that very specifically tailor to their needs, you know? They wrestle in so many different positions, and their practices aren't even, like, that much different from ours, you know? They have a very heavy emphasis on less conditioning and more actual wrestling. They spend so much time of their practice just on the mat wrestling, so they're able to figure out these positions.
And I guess, funny thing is, switching gears, again, I guess high school, having only lost one match, and then college, still had a really, really good season, but, you know, there are other people too. And so I guess, was it kind of difficult to realize that, hey, I'm not the presumed favorite anymore? And I guess my bigger question at large is, how much does, I guess, media coverage affect not only you, but I guess the team?
So there's multiple parts to that question, so I'll just tackle them a little differently.
Right.
Well, the main difference between high school and college, right, the wrestling, is you have to learn how to wrestle, because you're no longer wrestling – like, not great kids until you get to the semis and finals, and you may have some good kids. Every single kid is good. Every single kid that you wrestle in college is, like, a two-time state champ from their state. And they all want to win this match, and they're all fast, and they're all strong, and they all know how to wrestle. Every single kid's good. There's some kids that are way better than, you know, the good kids, which is what makes college wrestling so interesting. And you definitely have to make jumps, but it's so easy because by the time that you're a senior in high school, you're already so familiar with the sport, right? Hopefully you've been training, like, leading up to you're not just, like, walking onto a college team because you thought it was cool, you know, but you have a good enough grasp on the sport at that point that you can learn new technique and the new strategy on how to wrestle in college, because it's much more oriented around like hand fighting, shots, takedowns, and then riding. Because there's new rules too. You know, we have our danger rule, we have riding time, we have like the basically like a step out rule, where if I shoot you, it's stalling, right? So it's a lot more in depth, and it's kind of like learning a new variation of it, you know? And then, you know, coming out of high school being like the number one guy in the country into college where I'm just like another guy who's in the country. Like, it was definitely a little weird because, you know, I thought I was still like the best guy for the first like month or so. And I was like, oh, like, cool. Like, I'll just wrestle. And I realized like, oh, every single kid I'm wrestling is pretty decent. Like, and then it came early. Like, I was at my first year I redshirted and yep. I wrestled the Binghamton Open, right? The Bearcat Open. And I took my first college loss within the first like 3 weeks of our first 2 weeks of our season. Like, I lost to, I'm sorry. I blank on his name sometimes. He's from University of Ohio. Kelly.
Cam?
Cam Kelly?
No. Oh, God. My names are... Oh.
Well, anyway, I ended up wrestling just as I did in high school, and I ended up losing 6-4. And I was like, but what am I doing wrong? And it's like, I wasn't doing anything wrong. I just wasn't doing what I needed to do. You know, yeah. all of my technique was okay, but it wasn't what was needed for the match. You know, so making those adjustments definitely helped me build my mindset to where I still realize that I am one of the best people in the country, but there's competition. It's not defined. You know, I have to go out there and I have to scrap every single time if I want to be an NCAA champ. And it's nice comparative to high school where, like, you know, there's one definitive tournament that chooses the best kid in the country, you know, versus like high school. There's like six national tournaments and like not everyone enters each one. And it's like, oh, well, we have six national champs. Like, okay, cool. College, it's one kid is the best kid that year versus all the other schools, and it's pretty sick.
And do you think that like most wrestlers eventually come to prefer that all the stakes are basically put in one basket, more or less?
I think wrestling is just like formed, like created like that. Like, it's all a one-to-one battle sport, so you kind of want to see who's the best, you know. It's a very competitive sport, and I think the NCAAs is the right way to do it.
Well, then I guess switching gears on the NCAAs that wasn't this year, I guess. Mm-hmm. What were kind of some of the things, I don't want to say you were looking forward to doing, but had you done some sort of like visualization, as we love to say in the sport, as to what was going to happen?
For like my so I wasn't gonna wrestle in the NCAA tournament.
Oh, right. Woo. We'll keep that part in. That's another moment of mine where my mind just goes off the rails.
I'll still answer. I'd like to think that my teammates Chaz Tucker would have placed high in like the top four. And then I also thought my other teammate Noah Boffman was about to get it done in All American his senior year. But sadly both of them got a little cut short. But I was actually really looking forward to that NCAA tournament, so it's a bummer to us all, you know.
Well, then I guess switching gears, do you kind of feel like you lucked out almost in a sense that the stars aligned, that you didn't miss?
I'd hate to say I lucked out, you know, because I got hit pretty hard too. I mean, I definitely didn't lose a year of eligibility, but at the same time, like, I was training and competing to make the Olympic team.
That's
and
then true. That, yeah.
Won, come back next year. And I was like, but I was doing pretty well, guys. Like, I don't know if I want to come back. Pause for a year, like, that's not the greatest. And I was really upset that they were just going to cancel it altogether, because that would have been pretty detrimental to my overall career, because I, you know, can't wrestle forever.
Yeah.
So we got this Olympic, like, if it gets canceled, like, luckily it didn't get canceled, it just got postponed, but had it been canceled, I would have only been able to wrestle in like one Olympic game before I stopped wrestling, you know, because that next Olympics is going to be 7 years away. Like,
yeah,
I'm going to be 28 and still wrestling. Like, I, at some point I want to, like, you know, like, I don't know if I'd be able to last that long. Like, I know some people like JB and Kyle, like, could just keep wrestling when they're in their 30s. And I'm like, it's a lot to ask. You know, I've seen other people who are still wrestling in their 30s and they're like held together by tape.
The Olympic cycle is always longer than we perceive, right? The 4 years is a long time and your body can only handle so many of them before you just...
4 years is a long time of your sports career.
Yeah.
You know, the most senior level guys wrestle from the age of 21 to 30. 4 years is a significant part, like a significant portion of that time. So at least I'll be able to try and compete next year. So I'm happy with that. But you know, keeping everyone safe is probably much more of a priority than one individual person's dreams, you know? So I'm not bashing that the NCAA shut down the tournament, but at the end of the day, we all will be a little sad about it. Okay. Whether it was right or not is not up to me to decide.
Yeah. Unfortunately, wrestling's not like chess where you can play till you're 55 and just survive on booze until the end. But
yeah, you gotta – I mean, you could wrestle after. I've seen people coach well into their 70s, you know. But actual competition is – it's grueling, you know. I see people stop at, like, 25. They're like, I'm done.
Yeah. I guess we'll just talk about psychologically. Can you tell when somebody's trying to play mind games in a match?
Mind games in a match. I mean, it's pretty hard to. Sometimes, like, some people will obviously, like, let something be obvious, like hoping that you do shoot on it, right? Or like their misdirection game is kind of a mind game, right? So to make you perceive one thing and actually do another, or like, you know, there's plenty of like little tricks that you could do, I guess. Or, you know, just one of the best mind games is just like the Gilman strategy where you just run through them and make them think they have no hope of winning, you know? there's a couple of different like mind strategy, but as long as you have the mindset of like, I'm going to be in this match and I'm going to try as hard as I can in every single position and I'm going to do everything in my possible power to win, and just an unbreakable resolve, you know, it's tough to like get in my head, whereas like if you fake that leg and hope for me to shoot on it, like I'm gonna shoot on it. I'm gonna fucking take you down too. Like, so mind games are, it's hard to play an effective mind game in a physical fight.
Yeah. Cause at the end of the, okay. Yeah. And I guess, you throughout the progression of a season, especially your freshman year, when did you kind of realize that I've gotten out of kind of post high school, and instead of wanting to win and training really, really hard to win, having the realization that, yes, I can win the whole tournament at NCAAs?
Well, you know, I think those two go hand in hand. I thought I could win, you know, coming in. Even after I lost, I knew that, you know, I'm going to get better and I'm still going to do well. I don't think there was an exact pivotal point where I realized, you know, I have a shot of winning NCAAs, because I thought I could win the entire time, you know, with the ability that I have and, you know, the work ethic that I was willing to put in, I always thought I had a good shot. And even when I was, you know, starting to gain momentum and being like ranked higher and higher, I still wanted to get better. You know, there's no ceiling in wrestling. You can always get better. Like, even people like Jordan Burroughs and Kyle Dake can get better. And that's one of the crazy things, you know. Small, minute details just shifted a little bit can change everything. So I think one of the most important things for wrestlers is to never stop trying to get better. You know, always know that there's something that you can learn and it can help your wrestling. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah. I guess we'll address one more thing, and then I have when you have someone at the top of your weight class that is presumed as the favorite or the unbreakable.
You're referring to.
Yeah, correct? Yeah. How does that I don't want to say change, but like, you've got to know it's there in a way. And how do you go about approaching that and changing that, I guess?
Because, with like Spencer, you definitely know that he is the favorite, right? Whether that comes from different things or, because, you know, he's definitely really good at wrestling. But he's not unbeatable. Like, we've seen in multiple cases that where he's lost to, like, Piccinini pinned him. Yeah. Mara beat him. And all these people have defeated Spencer Lee, you know. He's not unbeatable. He's really good, but he's not unbeatable. Whether he stands at the top of all of us, wrestling is one of those sports where I can be worse than you and I can still win, you know. And at the end of the day, everyone wants to be the absolute best, but in the moment, I'll settle for winning.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to the NCAA tournament, and I'm thinking, you know, all right, Spencer Lee technically may be better than me right now, but I'm still going to win. I'm still going to wrestle as hard as I can and see if I can't just, like, come out on top, you know? I don't think there's any point where you should just give up hope, because there's always a chance. You know, he could make one simple mistake, and as long as I criticize on it, like, I could take the match. You know, same as what Piccinini did. Spencer Lee is better than Piccinini by far. His skill level is better than most of people at the weight. But Piccinini was able to gather up the cradle and just pin him, and that's it. Imagine you do that in the NCAA finals. Done.
Done. Yeah, there you go. Simple as that.
Behemoth just defeated.
There you go. And I guess one more thing before I let you go, because you're, you know, super busy. I'm wondering are you coming to Austin just for the match? Yeah. So you're still in Long Island right now.
I'm currently in training in Ithaca.
Ah, okay. So yeah.
Yeah. I'm just gonna come in, wrestle. Probably leave. I might have to end up quarantining for 2 weeks, but I don't know what their regulations are going to be. So we'll see.
All right. I guess one more thing. Did that? You saw the tweet, right? That.
Oh, that
Sammy decided that would be a genius idea to put out there.
Yeah, I saw it.
Okay. I guess I'll say that the only way I see that happening is if somehow they reopen the bars in Texas, and the night before, you just go out on Sixth Street and just, whoo, and show up.
I don't
and
even
go
know.
Up probably to Wayne's hungover, but and just
like, I'm not saying guy,
out of it.
I'm not saying the guy can't take me down. I don't. But like. I don't think he can turn me. You're going to have to get 5 takedowns if you want to tech me. Like, most people can't do that who are also, like, I don't know, like, Spencer Lee didn't take me down 5 times. Like, you think you're going to do it? Like, I don't know. I really don't see him going leg, single leg into a lace and rolling me up five times, you know. So, I mean, hey, like, more power to you. If you really think you could do it, like, we're going to meet up the 25th, so you could really, you know, go ahead and try. But know that I'm also going to be trying to wrestle, so we'll see what happens.
All right. So I guess unless he has the help of Austin Nightlife, it's not going to happen.
Even then, I think I'd be fine.
All right. The only reason why I say that is because I live, like, right outside of Austin. So.
Oh, nice, nice. Yeah. Yeah, I'll be coming to your backyard.
There you go. All right. Thank you so much for coming on. Sorry for my horrible Russian at the beginning, but worth the shot.
It's entertaining.
There you go. That's what this show's all about anyway.
Right.
All right. Well, best of luck in a week's time, and enjoy my state.
Thank you. See ya.
All right. Have a good one.
Thank you so much for tuning in to another edition of The Mental Takedown. Thank you again to Vito for doing this. It was a pleasure. And of course, best of luck this Thursday against Sammy on the flow card. He is certainly not short of confidence. Thank you so much again for tuning in. If you would be so kind to go ahead and follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and do all that other influencer jazz, that would be greatly appreciated. I have another interview coming out this week with another very, very talented 125 pounder, so keep your eyes peeled for that. Just one quick side note before I go, for those of you wondering where the 10th episode was, just keep in mind every multiple of 5, that's the 5th and 10th episode so far, is a live stream on YouTube, with me ranting and talking about all the things I've learned from this show. Otherwise, that'll be it for today. Thank you so much for tuning in, and have a great rest of your day.